I want to thank your pastor for inviting me to be here today. I love your pastor. I'm proud that he's a graduate of the Baptist College of Florida. I'm proud that most of your staff are graduates of the Baptist College of Florida, and we're working on an honorary degree for Ken Brookins, and we'll be complete then at that point. You keep on leading like that, we'll give you the whole thing. This weekend is a very special time when we remember the heroes among us. You know, most folks who turn out to be heroes don't start out that way. They're just ordinary men and women who are placed in sometimes extraordinary circumstances. And they have to depend upon a power far outside themselves for the results that men later call heroic. I enjoyed watching the baptismal service, and I'm reminded that in the area of Cotorupu, Brazil, the northeast corner of that massive country, we now have some 200 church planters, evangelists, who have been trained through your Baptist College of Florida, who are now out working, serving our Lord, reaching those desperately poor people. We also have active now work going on among the Quilombolas and seeing those villages that were started by runaway slaves. They ran into the darkness of the jungle, and now God's heroes are bringing the light of the gospel, and they're responding in magnificent numbers. Thank you for giving me and those other folks who are associated with your Baptist College of Florida the privilege of being involved in that work. Well, all of us at one time or another would like to be a superhero, wouldn't we? I mean, far beyond normal hero. The kind of superhero who can penetrate any wall with their gaze, who can leap tall buildings at a single bound, who can do all of the magnificent things. I'm amazed at how many people are into superheroes. My grandchildren especially are into superheroes. Now, you who are old enough to know that grandchildren are wonderful knew I would get them in the message somewhere, and so I'll just start off with them. But the fact is, when they were much younger, I came home one day to find the floor was covered with little bits of fabric. It looked like there had been an explosion in a textile factory in our house. But it was way too quiet for all five of our grandchildren to be there. And then almost as if by signal, they all leapt out from behind plants and furniture, and they were all arrayed in their superhero costumes. They had their sashes on. They had their eye covering on. They had all of their capes on. And Mama had been very busy all day making superhero costumes. And that's cute for kids. But there are times it would be convenient if we could be superheroes, wouldn't it? There are times that it would be extremely convenient. I've thought about leaping tall buildings at a single bound, no taller than I am. I'd just like to be able to get up on the curb successfully. You know, it doesn't take much to make me happy. But it doesn't take long either to recognize that we're not superheroes, are we? We're just men and women. Some of us, sinners, saved by the grace of God in Christ Jesus. Some of us who don't yet know that joy, and my prayer is today that you will know that joy in Christ. But it doesn't take much more than getting up in the morning, looking into the mirror, and after you get over the shock of the ravages of the night and the years that have already passed by, you recognize, I'm not really a superhero. I'd like to be. So this morning, as we're talking about the heroes who have served this nation well, let us remember that we all have the opportunity to to be heroes to somebody. We all have the opportunity to be that hero who might not come in with heavy artillery fire and bring freedom to a city or a nation, but we do have the opportunity to come in by the authority of the Word of God and in the power of His holy Word, bring freedom to a lost heart, bring hope to a struggling family, bring wholeness and peace to a broken home, bring repair and new life to shattered dreams and hopes along the way. Well, if we know very clearly that we're not superheroes, where do we go for the strength to become the hero that somebody desperately needs? The writer of the book of Hebrews gives us what I believe is an absolute recipe for where do would-be heroes go when they recognize that their cape is ripped, their sword is bent, and their fighting steed has lost a shoe along the way. Where do we turn? Where do we go when we realize just how weak we are over against the opportunities and the challenges that lie before us? The writer of Hebrews was writing to first century Christians. Here were a group of folks who had been challenged with the good news of the gospel. They had known what it meant to have ritual religion. They had known what it meant to be spectators as the religious leaders took part in ceremony. But now they who had known the comfort of ritual religion were challenged to follow after this man called Jesus. They were challenged to go and follow one who had been nailed to a cross, who had died a shameful death, who had been placed in a borrowed tomb, and now, according to rumor that they had heard, had risen from the dead, but according to the official church line, his body had been stolen. What do you do facing that kind of a choice? What do you and I do facing that kind of choice? Because every day we are enticed by the comfort of ritual. We are enticed by our own comfort zone. We are enticed by letting somebody else be Christian for us. Far too often today we see a need that needs to be met, so we hire somebody else to do it for us, rather than launching out in the name of Jesus Christ to be involved on an ongoing basis in His great mission. These folks were facing such a challenge. Stay back in the comfort of your ritual, or launch out into the mainstream of first century Christianity and be personally involved in missions. They were, as it would seem, holding on with one hand to the past, with one foot firmly planted there, and yet being called to reach out with the other hand to the great work of Christ in His church, and one foot timidly being placed toward there, much like an individual standing on a dock and placing one foot in a boat and then trying to make up your mind where to go. If you've ever been in that predicament, you know what will happen pretty quickly. You can't stand there very long. You will either jump back into the ritual, get into the boat, or go for full immersion of uncertainty. And so these folks received a letter under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit of God. Hebrews chapter 4, beginning with verse 14, we find a beautiful little segment of this letter, in which I believe God says to me and will say to you today, here is where you turn when heroic action is required, but you recognize that on your own, you're not a superhero. The writer of Hebrews says in Hebrews chapter 4, beginning with verse 14, Seeing then that we have a great high priest who has passed into the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold fast our profession. For we have not an high priest which cannot be touched with the feeling of our infirmities, but was in all points tempted like as we are, yet without sin. Let us therefore come boldly unto the throne of grace, in order that we might obtain mercy and find grace to help in time of need. Where do we go when the task is too much? Where do we go when our strength is inadequate? Where do would-be heroes find their sustenance? First of all, we go to the reality of the identity of our high priest. You see, he says, seeing then that we have a great high priest. He has been talking about the priesthood of Christ. He has been talking about the sufficiency of the word. And now he comes to this point and he says, when we recognize our own inadequacy, we can recognize that we are not alone in this venture. On a planet with over 6 billion people hurtling through space, crowded in on this little piece of matter in the midst of God's creation, the most common complaint of modern mankind is loneliness. Nobody knows me. Nobody cares. Nobody is concerned about my soul. Well, friend, I've got contradictory good news for you this morning. Somebody knows you, somebody cares, and somebody cares about the condition of your soul, and his name is Jesus, the one and only Son of God, the great high priest of God's people. He says, you are not alone. And some of you might say, but preacher, you don't know where I live. You don't know the conditions under which I live. And you're absolutely right. But the fact is, my God knows, and your great high priest knows, and you're not alone. No matter how dark the night, no matter how steep the hill, no matter how tough the situation, no matter how heavy the burden, he says, you are not alone. For lo, I am with you always, even unto the end of the age, even unto the great day of our Lord Jesus Christ. We are promised the security of the companionship of the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Seeing then that we have a great high priest, far greater than the line of Aaron, far greater than the Levitical priesthood, because you see, those priests were chosen from among men, and before they could give sacrifice for the people, they had to make sacrifice for their own sins. But our great high priest is the sinless Son of God. You have a great high priest, and his name is Jesus. The very Son of God, the very crown jewel of heaven, became the baby of Bethlehem. And the baby of Bethlehem became the boy confounding the priest and the teachers in the temple. And the boy from the temple became the carpenter of Nazareth. And the carpenter of Nazareth became the itinerant preacher. And the itinerant preacher became our crucified Christ. Our crucified Christ became our resurrected Lord. Our resurrected Lord is currently our great high priest. And our great high priest is our soon returning Savior. That's good news, folks. That's enough to get a backslidden Baptist happy and going again. You see, we have a great high priest, and his name is Jesus. And what does he say about him? Who has passed into the heavens. Oh, thank God. For the Hebrew mind, the heavens were multiple layers of almost a bronze-like material that could not be penetrated. But what he says here is, our great high priest was not held in by human form like we are. He wasn't held in by a sinful body like we are. The manger couldn't hold him. The temple couldn't hold him. The cross couldn't hold him. The tomb couldn't hold him. The universe couldn't hold him. He has ascended back to his rightful place. He gave up the privileges of heaven for a little while in order that you and I could enjoy the privileges of heaven for eternity. And that's why he did it. And that's why we know we're not alone, because he's the unchanging God. The unchanging God of creation, the unchanging God of Calvary, the unchanging God of today for whatever your need. He has ascended into heaven as the great pioneer of the faith so that we pilgrims can follow him. I grew up in South Georgia, what little growing up I did. And we worked on something of a sharecropping situation. We cropped a lot, but didn't share much, so I don't know if it really was sharecropping. But the fact is, Daddy saved some money every year to take us on a vacation. Usually it was to go to a relative's house so that they could bring all their kids to our house and we could all be told it was a vacation. But this particular year was the first year that Daddy and Mama were taking us to a foreign country. It was a place called Chattanooga, Tennessee. Now, if you had never been north of Albany before, Chattanooga was like going to a foreign country. And I remember on the way up there, we began to see signs that said, "See Rock City." I thought, wow, an entire city carved out of a rock. I can't wait to see that. And then we got closer, and the signs changed and said, "See Ruby Falls." I thought, wow, a southern Niagara, a whole mountainside covered with water, cascading down into large lakes and great pools. Well, if you've ever been to Ruby Falls, you know it ain't that. It's far more like a mountain with a plumbing problem than it is a southern Niagara. And so, we finally got there. And we drove that old Chevrolet station wagon up the mountainside and came to a little stone building. We got out of that car, went in that building, walked over to the elevator, got in the elevator, and pressed the button that said down. Now, that was something brand new. I'd never been underground on purpose before. And we went down for what seemed to be forever. And then we got out of that elevator. And we began walking through a cave. And it was a cave with electric light bulbs hanging on a little spring-looking thing up there. And on either side, it was covered in things I'd never seen. I mean, there were stalagmites and stalactites and various Baptists, and everything along in there. And there was a crowd of folks behind me that I didn't know, and there was one man out front, and it was dark beyond him. I was holding on to Mama's hand, walking along. Now, that probably seems strange to you today, but I've not always been the tall, athletic type I am now. I used to be a short, chunky guy. But the fact is, I was holding Mama's hand, and after we walked for a while through that cave, the guide stopped, and he reached over, and he pulled a switch, and it got so dark. You ever notice you don't talk out loud when it's that dark? It got whisper dark. And after what seemed to be an eternity, his voice penetrated the darkness, and I'll never forget what he said. He said, "Don't worry, folks. I'm going to turn the lights back on in a few moments. But even if we didn't have these lights here, I could take you to your destination because you see, I've been this way before. Child of God, I want to say to you this morning, when you recognize that you're not a superhero on your own, the very great high priest of heaven wants to say to you, when the walls seem to be closing in, when the world seems to be collapsing on your head, when the crowd is pushing from behind and darkness is all you can see ahead, I'm ready, my child, to lead you to the very throne room of God, because I've been here. I've passed this way, and you can trust me. Oh, thank God for the identity of our high priest. Well, when we recognize that we're not heroes on our own, and we recognize our great need, we can go not only to the identity of our high priest, but we can look at the sympathy of our high priest. He goes on to say, for we have not a high priest which cannot be touched with the feeling of our infirmities, but was in all points tempted like as we are, yet without sin. What he's saying is, folks, he is sympathetic with our situation. I run into folks all the time who say, well, I think I'm just going to give up. I think I'm just going to quit. I say, why in the world are you going to quit? They say, well, I've been tempted. I might as well just quit. Well, welcome to the club. We've all been tempted. The sin doesn't come in being tempted. The sin comes into giving into the temptation. When we are tempted and give in, it is a proclamation that our God is not able, and my God is able, and your God is able. And he understands our weakness. He loves you warts and all. The world will love you today and throw you away tomorrow. We are in a cast-off society where life means absolutely nothing in the popular economy. But for a world where life means nothing, your life was worth the precious blood of Jesus Christ. And he still loved you just that much. And he understands your weakness. And he understands your temptation. And he was tempted just like we are. He was tempted with popularity. He was tempted with short circuit success. He was tempted with physical appetite. And Satan says, I have a plan for you. But Jesus looked at him and said, you may have a plan for me, but my Father has a purpose. There's a lot of difference in a plan and a purpose. And he has said that his purpose for us is wrapped up in the purpose of giving us hope and a future. Oh, praise God. He understands. I was reading the 139th Psalm earlier this morning and looking at where it says, where can I go that you're not there? You understand. You made me. I'm fearfully and wonderfully made because of you. He understands all the intricacies of what's going on. And he loves us. The Creator loves the creation. What a Savior. What a God we serve. He understands our temptation, and he is touched with the feeling of our infirmities. God not only understands, he cares. He cares deeply about what you're facing today. You know, it would have been easy enough for God to have said, well, I tell you what, I'll just stand off at arm's distance. I'll be something like a celestial orchestra conductor, and I'll tell you come in here and you come in there. But he didn't do that. He didn't stay off at a distance. He who created man out of the dust of the earth rolled up his sleeves, and he touched the blind and made them see. He touched the leper and made them clean. He touched the dead and made them live again. And he touched this old sinful heart, and he saved it and made it new. Thank God. He didn't keep his distance. Dare we do anything less? And finally, in those last few hours before Calvary, that same God of creation who created man out of the dust of the earth knelt down and he took a towel and he took a basin and he washed the dirty feet of his creation. That bunch of slow learners, and lest we think them too slow, they had only had 3 years. We've had 2,000. And yet we don't understand all that he says and all that he's about for us. He understands your need. He knows where that person went that you don't see in the mirror anymore of a morning. And he knows that he loves us even when the world doesn't. So when we recognize that we're not a superhero, and yet the situations around us require a hero, let us turn to the identity of our high priest. Let us turn to the sympathy of our high priest. And finally, let us turn to the access through our high priest. He says, let us therefore come boldly unto the throne of grace in order that we might obtain mercy and find grace to help in time of need. Once we recognize that we do have a great high priest, once we recognize that our great high priest understands us and loves us and provides for us anyway, then where do we go for help from our high priest? You see, the scripture says, let us therefore. Now, anytime you're reading scripture and it says therefore, you need to ask, what's the therefore, therefore? This therefore is based upon the identity and the sympathy of our high priest. Because of who Christ is and because of what Christ has done for us and in us, we can go boldly to the very throne room of God. Not bold in our own goodness, but bold in his unchanging character. The writer of Hebrews would say in another place, Jesus Christ the same yesterday and today and forever. He loves you just as much as he did when he was hanging on Calvary's cross. His power is just as great as it was on that first Easter morning when he arose from the grave victorious. And he hasn't changed his mind about you. Let us therefore come boldly. Not bold in our own goodness. Now I realize that down here in Bay County and whatever other county you might live in, you probably don't have some of the folks that we have up where I live. But we have some folks who are so full of themselves, they can strut sitting down. They don't even have to stand up, strut. That's not who this scripture is talking about. You don't come boldly in your own goodness. We come bold in his goodness. Let us come boldly unto the throne of grace. Aren't you glad he doesn't say the throne of justice? Oh, I know some folks will say, well, I tell you what, I'm a self-made man. I'll tell you something. If you're a self-made man or woman, you're lost as a goose in a hailstorm because we can't make salvation. Salvation is a gift of God in Christ Jesus so that no man or woman might boast in their own goodness. Others will come along, I just want what's rightfully mine. I want what's coming to me. Not this boy. Mm-mm. Because on my own, I deserve hell and eternal separation from Jesus. But because of my great high priest, I've got heaven and company with him for eternity. Oh, what a Savior. Let us therefore come boldly unto the throne of grace in order that we might obtain mercy and find grace to help when just in the nick of time. Does that mean he's been off somewhere all along the way? No, he's been right there all along waiting on us to come home. Now, folks, in these few hours of this weekend, you'll hear a lot and see a lot about heroes, and thank God for it. I'm proud to have worn the uniform. I'm proud of our flag. I'm proud of our country. We've got our problems, but thank God we're free to talk about them and to worship our Lord in this great land. Thank God for this United States of America. But I want to tell you what. Those wars come and go. But we are in a battle for the very lives of men and women on planet Earth for now and eternity. We dare not shrink from the opportunity or the challenge. We dare not think we can do it on our own. And so when we recognize the enormity of the task and the insufficiency of our strength, because of who Christ is and because of what Christ has done and the fact that he still loves and sustains us. When the battle cry rings out, let us therefore come boldly unto the throne of grace in order that we might obtain mercy and find grace to help in time of need, and then go out into the battle a mighty army, joined in heart, joined in head, joined in spirit, joined in purpose, that his kingdom come and his will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Heavenly Father, I pray today that you'll bless your people. Lord, I pray today that you'll touch those who might have heard something out of your word, not because of any thing I said, but because your word is living and quick and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword. But I pray, Lord, that in your word they have found comfort and hope and challenge and surety. Father, I pray that they will come today accepting what you have done for each of us, that it might become that which is being done in them and not just for them. Heavenly Father, I pray today that your people who already know you as Savior, but maybe are tired, maybe have grown a little indifferent, maybe have backed off some in their walk with you. Heavenly Father, I pray that you'll convict us and you'll remind us that you gave your very all for us. And anything less than that is unacceptable for us to give back to you. Heavenly Father, I pray today that as we sing this song, it's so easy to sing, "I surrender all," and just be thinking of getting out of here and getting on with the activities of the weekend. Oh, but Heavenly Father, please still our hearts, focus our minds, remind us of our weakness and your strength. But remind us, Lord, that your strength is made perfect in our weakness. And your perfect strength is available to us. But Father, it's not going to be available as long as we're trying to hold on to the world with one hand and reaching out to you with the other. Father, let us truly surrender all. Surrender our hold on the things of the world. Surrender our hold on our self-sufficiency. Surrender our hold on our pride and our prejudice and all of the other things that would come between us and surrender to you. Father, our Lord Jesus Christ turned loose of the privileges of heaven for a season. Lord, let us turn loose of anything that would keep us from embracing you. And let us today surrender it to you that we might become that servant hero who will be your instrument in a lost world. And we'll thank you for it in Jesus' name. Amen. Folks, I don't know the condition of your life, but I do know this. There's a Savior who's sufficient for every need. And there's a Savior who's calling us to reach out to him, to turn loose of anything that would keep us from following after him. Today, my invitation to you is simple. Trust God to be who he says he is and to do what he says he'll do. And let him take care of the rest. Perhaps you're saying, I don't know all the theology. Well, my goodness, you're not being called to become a theologian. You're being called to become a child of the King and let him take care of growing you up and the way that he'd have you to go. Whatever God's leading today, there'll be those here to receive you. But let me urge you, don't come and sit and listen as you have done so well today and go away untouched and unchanged by his word.